Jennifer, thank you very much for that gracious introduction. And as you were talking about the Roosevelts, I could not help but think about FPA's connection to the Roosevelts. Eleanor, when she decided to venture forth from this home, maybe to avoid her mother-in-law, opted to join the board of directors of the Foreign Policy Association. And FDR gave one of his last major speeches to the Foreign Policy Association. It was a speech that was delivered at the Waldorf Astoria with 1,600 people present, and in it he argued passionately for the formation of the United Nations. President Robb, President Bachelet, I could not think of a better place than Roosevelt House at Hunter College to have President Bachelet speak on the role of women's health in economic development in the Dame Gillian Sackler Lecture Series on Global Health Issues. Hunter has helped to educate generations of extraordinary women. President Robb's leadership of this institution has been exceptional, indeed inspired, and we are pleased at the FPA to be cooperating with Roosevelt House, Hunter's Public Policy Institute. I too want to thank Elbrin Kimmelman for the role she has played in nurturing this relationship, and I want to say that no organization could have more dedicated directors than Elbrin Kimmelman and Dame Gillian Sackler, who is also with us this evening. For the Foreign Policy Association, this is the third time that President Bachelet has graced our forum, and I should begin by saying that she is the first Undersecretary General and Executive Director of UN Women, a post established on July 21st, 2010 by the United Nations General Assembly. UN Women works with the entire UN system, governments, civil society, and the private sector to advance women's empowerment and gender equality worldwide. President Bachelet most recently served as president of her country of Chile from 2006 to 2010. A longtime champion of women's rights, she has advocated for gender equality and women's empowerment throughout her career. Among her initiatives as president, she tripled the number of free early childcare centers for low-income families and completed some 3,500 child care centers around the country. President Bachelet has also served as her country's Minister of Defense, where she introduced gender policies intended to improve the conditions of women in the military and police forces. And as Minister of Health of Chile, she implemented health care reform, improving attention to primary care facilities with the aim of ensuring better and faster health care response for families. When we presented the FPA Medal to President Bachelet in 2006 at the Waldorf Astoria, the same place where President Roosevelt spoke to us, I wasn't there though at the time, the citation read in part, "As the first woman to be elected President of Chile, Michelle Bachelet brings a special perspective of inclusion." In her inaugural address, she stated, "I want a government in which citizens have active participation, a government at the service of the people." Her ambitions for Chile are being recognized in record time as she fulfills her promises. Those were the words from the citation. President Bachelet, we are delighted to have you with us again, and the floor is yours.
Good evening to all of you, and I want to thank you, Noel, for your kind introduction, and also thank the Foreign Policy Association for inviting me to deliver this lecture. I would also like to thank President Jennifer Robb and Hunter College for hosting us tonight, and congratulate you both of this partnership, but also on your leadership of extraordinary institutions. We need institutions like yours that foster global understanding and citizenship. My very special thanks go to you, Dame Gillian Sackler, for your vision and leadership. Tonight, allow me to speak about a topic that I care deeply about. To me, this is a matter which is fundamental to our progress and shared prosperity as human beings and vital to democracy, to peace, and to security. And I'm speaking about the health and rights of women and girls. For, as you have already heard, for 2 years now, as the Executive Director of UN Women, I've had the privilege of reaching out around the world, advocating for the rights of women and girls, being a global spokesperson for gender equality. But I have also pushed for, and I witness, rising global attention to women's rights and ending violence and discrimination against women. And we're making progress. In all regions, countries have expanded women's legal entitlements. More women are exercising leadership in politics and business. More girls are going to school, and more women survive childbirth and can plan their families. There is now, if I would say, global awareness that improving the status of women should be a political priority. Having said that, that doesn't mean that we are in the perfect situation. On the contrary, despite this progress, there's tremendous gaps remain, and we need to transform awareness into stronger action. Action to tackle persistent wage gaps and unequal opportunities. Action to increase women's leadership and decision-making. Action to end child marriage and stop shocking levels of violence against girls and women. And we need stronger action to advance the health and rights of women. And I say this because whether we're talking about the political arena or the parliament or during peace and or during conflict, women's bodies continue to be a battleground. Rape continues to be used as a tactic of war. Millions of women are missing due to gender discrimination, female feticide, and reproductive rights continue to be hotly debated. You may be surprised to learn that within the United Nations, the topic of reproductive health and rights are followed as closely by some delegates as nuclear disarmament. Yet all too often, the voices that should be heard, the voices of women, are not an equal part of the debate at both international and national levels. This is why I'm a strong proponent of expanding women's leadership in politics, in parliaments, in peace talks, and in the private sector. I think it's time that the voices of women are heard. This is especially important when it comes to improving women's health and advancing women's rights. Today, far too many women are denied a voice, denied choices, and denied control of their own bodies. What guides us forward is the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. That's one of our fundamental bases, if I would say, a framework, the CEDAW Convention. The action programs from the 1994 International Conference on Population and Development, the so-called Cairo Conference. Now we're going to be in two more years, it's going to be 20 years after Cairo, and there will be the need to assess what has come after that. And also in 1995, Fourth World Conference of Women, the so-called the Beijing Conference, and will we also soon have 20 years from Beijing, and we'll need, that is 2015, and there will be the need to assess what of those plan of action were really implemented and what is left to continue, I would say, pushing. And also, we talked about that last year, the UN Security Council resolutions on women, peace, and security. So thanks, I would say, to the International Women's Rights Treaty and advocacy by many, reproductive rights are increasingly protected in national legislation and advanced through policies and programs. And this is important because reproductive rights are fundamental to gender equality and women's empowerment, but also to peace and security and to economic development. And thanks to the Security Council resolutions, actions are being taken to involve more women in peace and security and to prevent and punish sexual violence during conflict. I, as you can imagine, travel worldwide, and in preparing for my visit to countries and going over the different characteristics, their development path, and national indicators, I have found a consistent pattern. I'm not going to win the Nobel Prize for this because this is not something completely original. I just want to mention something that I think I have found it, but it's already founded by others too. And that probably one of the more important indicators of the situation in a country is the health status of a woman. I mean, it's a more, the health and well-being of women and girls is, it's a good indicator of health, because of health in a country, because usually women have less access. So it really shows what happens to the more vulnerable ones. But it's also, I would say, a good picture of what's happened in the whole country in terms of opportunities and rights. Now, I'm not saying this is not exact science, but I'm saying that one can tell a lot about a country and its current status and future prospects by examining certain indicators, such as the lifetime risk of maternal death, the percentage of women using modern contraception, female mortality, I mean child mortality rates, women's literacy rate, and their participation in national government, and of course, girls' enrollment in school. If you look at the countries with the highest rates of maternal mortality and disability, the countries were in the worst place in the world to be a mother or an infant or growing up, you find countries in deep distress, such as Afghanistan, Chad, or Somalia. And the reverse is also true. The countries with the highest level of gender equality, Nordic countries such as Norway, Finland, Iceland, and Sweden, the countries where women have the best health and education standards, but also economic opportunities and political participation, are the countries that are performing well and rank the highest in development and human development. Interesting, though, is probably the tendency will be to make the link the other way around. And people will tell you, well, because you are rich countries, you can invest in women and girls. And when you talk to the Minister of Gender Equality of the five Nordic countries, three are men, they tell you, on the contrary, we are rich because when we were, I mean, at the beginning of the last century, we weren't rich countries. We were small countries with lots of challenges. And we thought that the possibility of development was linked to using something so obvious and basic like our whole potential, men and women. I'm not saying rocket science here, but it looks like still it's not clear for everyone. And then that's why we're rich now, because we invest, we ensure education, health of boys and girls, and opportunity for men and women. So this that sounds strange is not strange, because when you talk to some governments, they tell you, no, we cannot do this because we're poor. And not looking at investment in women and girls as an important factor of their capacity as a society and even their economy. And you know, there are lots of indicators that show the important contribution that women can bring to all the society, but also to the economy. So to remember what we're saying, the highest countries with the highest rank on gender equality are usually the ones with better economic performance and also human development. The healthiest and most vibrant society have women and men who are healthy and can exercise their human right. And this is true for countries, but also is true for companies. And nations and corporations perform better when women enjoy equal opportunity and can play their full and equal role. And this is not just my personal opinion or the ideology of a group of feminists, or this is a finding of an ever-growing number of studies and reports from governments, from universities, from think tanks, organizations, the private sector, the World Economic Forum, etc. And let me share with you some examples. The World Bank finds that greater gender equality enhances productivity, improves development outcomes for the next generation, and makes institutions more representative. And also some people mentioned, I don't have any evidence of that to tell you the truth, but just talking 2 days ago with the president of Haiti, and that he was trying to incorporate more women in, he said, you know what, I think that women work a lot, they're very workaholic, but also less corrupted than men. And I told him, I have the same impression, I said. But to be honest, because I'm always the person who tries to really believe, think if what I'm saying is the truth or not, I'm not so sure if we're better in terms of less corrupted, or if women haven't had the opportunity in the history yet to get there. I want to believe that they're less corrupted, and in my experience, that has been the case. But I have to give the benefit of the doubt that maybe it's a matter of time. But I want to believe that women have always this need to have a mission, and to really make the mission the more essential issue of their life. I said findings of the World Bank, findings of the UNDP, United Nations Development Program, finds that women's empowerment is catalytic and central to economic growth, social development, but also environmental sustainability. The World Economic Forum is in its Global Gender Gap report finds that gender equality correlates positively with economic growth when they study across 134 countries. Goldman Sachs finds that reducing barriers to female labor force participation would increase America's GDP by 9%, the Eurozone by 13%, and Japan by 16%. So it's also very clear, and a lot of studies show that unlocking the potential of women could lead to a 14% rise in per capita incomes by the year 2020 in several countries and several economies, including China, Russia, Indonesia, Vietnam, and Korea. On the other hand, the FAO, the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, finds that providing women farmers with the same access as men to land, credit, fertilizer, and other inputs could increase national crop yields by up to 4% and advance food security and reduce hunger. They have estimated that could mean the reduction of 100 to 150 million people without hunger. And the management consultant McKinsey & Company finds that companies with higher proportion of women on their management committee have the best performance. So I would say there's a lot of evidence, and I'm not going to bore you with more, you know, thousands of figures, because we have those. But I think all this evidence lets us to conclude that maintaining inequality between men and women can no longer be considered an option. In our complex world, and given unprecedented economic, demographic, environmental, and political challenges, I think we simply can no longer afford to waste the potential of half of population. It's estimated that on the 7 billion people, at least 3.5 billion are women, and also 3.5 billion are young people. So there are two challenges there, because we have seen how the worlds have evolved, the high levels of female unemployment, the high levels of youth unemployment, et cetera. And I think the struggle for gender equality and women's rights is the greatest cause of the 21st century. You will say, okay, you're the executive director of UN Women. What else can you say? But I truly believe it. I mean, in terms of what it can contribute to the world. So now we have known for a long time that the health status of women and the disparities in health between the sexes are often critical indicators of inequality in society. And countries with high rates of fertility and high rates of maternal and child mortality are countries characterized as least developed. And of course, the reverse is also true. As nation grows richer, people enjoy better health and living standard. However, I have to say, it sounds adequate, and you can imagine. GDP per capita goes higher, so there can be also more fiscal space for public spending in health. You can improve in nutrition, and that is so essential of health. And you can expand access to health service, etc. So you will be having better results, better health outcome. But studies in South Asia, and I'm not going to name any country because I don't want to get into trouble, has shown that not necessarily the country who have grown faster in the economy had better health outcomes, because you need to have also good public policies that can ensure the health outcomes. And so money is not, I mean, you need money. You need to have economic growth, but it's not mechanical. The relation is unfortunately not mechanical. So because we have seen that countries with lower, and I could mention two countries that are very good examples Sri Lanka, for example, or Vietnam, they don't have as high velocity of economic growth, but they have defined political public policies to ensure access to health and to nutrition, et cetera, and they have been able to really drop dramatically by 50%, by 65%, the rates of maternal mortality, female children mortality, et cetera. So with higher income levels means that countries have more money to improve women's health. Ultimately, it comes down to how governments decide to invest and to spend the money. So we know that if governments spend the money to improve the health and legal status of women, of course, this improves social conditions and advances also economic performance. By providing equal opportunities, empowering girls and women with health and education, and leveraging their talent and leadership in the economy, politics, and society, countries succeed and stay competitive in today's globalized, fast-changing, and interconnected environment. There is a study of McKinsey and Company that shows that in this particular economic challenges in the world, the companies who want to be more productive and need to have leadership with certain capacities. And they study it and they identify like 10 different attitudes in terms of innovation, creativity, but very concrete ones. And I have to say that, of course, there are many of them that are shared by women and men, but there are some that are really very predominant in women. So it's really part of the solution. To have enough women and enough men that can produce that, you know, that synergy, that creativity, that innovation that will permit the economy to continue growing. But investing in women and girls, I think, is always important, but it's particularly important at this juncture. Looking forward, we see emerging trends that demand a health response across sectors with a special focus on women. What I'm talking about population dynamics, climate change, the rise of middle-income countries, and the growing burden on non-communicable disease. And these are not non-important issues, because we used to think that the poor people of the world live in poor countries, and that's not true anymore. Two decades ago, that was true. But now, 72% of the poor of the world live in middle-income countries. So that means we need to approach things in a different way. We know that countries where population trends growth are high and higher are in middle-income countries right now. So we need to look at things a little bit different. Today, non-communicable diseases, cancers, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, are taking a rising toll on women and are responsible for more than 60% of all deaths globally. Nearly 80% of these deaths occur in low and middle-income countries. By 2030, it is projected that non-communicable diseases in low-income countries will surpass communicable, maternal, perinatal, and nutritional diseases combined. And this is a rising threat that can push households into poverty and adversely affect national economies. So urgent efforts are needed to deliver integrated health services that meet women's needs and to promote healthy lifestyles. But we must also pay greater attention to population dynamics. I have to say, I see very little written on population dynamics. There was a time that was very important. Now, I don't see much that factor included in the analysis. But today, we are, all of us are one of those 7 billion people on Earth. And while people are living longer and healthier lives, huge inequities persist and need to be tackled. The current pace of growth is adding about 78 million more people every year. And almost all growth is occurring in urban areas in less developed countries, some of which already struggle to meet their people's needs. At the same time, many rich and middle-income countries are concerned about low fertility, declining populations, and aging. As the global population grows from the current 7 billion to almost 9 billion by 2040, and the number of the middle-class consumers increases by 3 billion over the next 20 years, that are the estimation, the demand for resources will rise exponentially. By 2030, the world will need at least 50% more food, 45% more energy, and 30% more water, all at a time when environmental boundaries are throwing up new limits to supply. So it is an important issue. And I believe that our ability to live together on a healthy planet will depend on ethical leadership that addresses inequality, disparities, and discrimination in society. We need inclusive leadership that promotes and protects equal opportunities, human dignity, and human rights. And we see this so clearly when we examine the health of women. Perhaps the most shocking statistic regarding women's health is the fact that nearly 4 million women are missing in our world from infanticide, neglect, and other unnatural causes. Of these missing women, 2/5 were never born. 1/5 die in infancy and childhood, and the remaining 2/5 die between the ages of 15 and 29. And the causes range from overt discrimination, a preference for boys and girls, a total lack of resources in the household for children, and maternal mortality and HIV/AIDS for women of reproductive age. Due to gender discrimination and violence, women are more likely to contract HIV. HIV infection rates of young women aged 15 to 24 are twice as high as those of men. In many cases, women simply do not have the means to protect themselves. In sub-Saharan Africa, home of the majority of people living with HIV, there is only one female condom available for every 36 women. If we examine all health indicators, maternal mortality represents the greatest inequality between rich and poor. Every day, 800 women die from complications of pregnancy and childbirth. That means 2 women every minute, in something that is so natural and physiological. Every year, such complications leave more than 10 million women with physical and mental disabilities. And it's awful when you go to some countries and you see all those women live with fistula, because, I mean, they have terrible conditions. They are completely stigmatized from their families, and they don't have access. I mean, they had a birth that was complicated because they didn't have access to professional attention, and afterwards it's a nightmare for those women. We know that globally maternal mortality is due to a lack of access to quality health services. The high rate of maternal mortality, with the vast majority of deaths occurring in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, also had root causes in poverty and gender inequality, in low access to education, especially for girls, because in early marriage, in adolescent pregnancy, and in low access to sexual and reproductive health information, first of all, and services, including for adolescents. One, I mean, I think there's a lot of things important if we want to deal with maternal mortality. It's how we ensure not only access to family planning, and there's a big private sector, governmental, and UN activity on this area to ensure that people can have options, but also education. If I may use this health word, education is almost a vaccine, because when girls don't drop out of school and can finish, hopefully the whole secondary school, we see a dramatic drop on all these indicators: maternal mortality, early forced marriage, early forced pregnancy, et cetera, et cetera. We know that the more that the women's rights are respected, including the right to sexual and reproductive health, the lower the rates of mothers dying during pregnancy and childbirth, the lower the rates of teenage girls getting pregnant, and the lower the rates of abortion. We also know from analyzing macroeconomic data that improvements in reproductive health reduce fertility rates, lead to better nutrition, health, and education of children, and increase the number of women participating in the labor market, which fuels economic growth. Between 1960 and 1995, the rapid economic growth of the so-called Asian tigers, Hong Kong, Singapore, South Korea, and Taiwan, was fueled by increases in people of working age, increase in female labor force participation, and increases in education. Those were the 3 factors. Research shows that countries that have expanded opportunities for women and girls in education and work have largely achieved greater prosperity and social progress. And one very good example is Bangladesh, which has registered significant gains since the 70s. Bangladesh has been able to reduce child and maternal mortality, increase life expectancy, increase the number of girls in school, and reduce fertility from an average of 7 children to 2 children on average per woman today. This example shows the tremendous benefits of empowering women. Lives have improved, and the Bangladesh economy has managed to grow more than 6% a year during the past decade. My friend, today and every day, individuals like you and institutions like the Foreign Policy Association and Hunter College are coming together to advance the rights of women and to advance public health. This year, UN Women joined UNAIDS, and we joined other UN agencies and organizations in a global partnership to advance the health of every woman and every child. And since the partnership was launched in 2010, over 200 partners have made policy, service delivery, and financial commitments to advance the global strategy for women's and children's health, totaling over $40 billion. These commitments are paying off. HIV/AIDS is coming under control, slowly but steadily. In every country, men and women and young people are mobilized to end violence and discrimination against women and girls. The health of women and children is improving. So progress is being made in all regions, yet accelerated action is needed. Access to family planning could cut maternal death by an estimated of 20 to 25%. Yet today, some 222 million women who would like to plan and space their birth still lack access to effective contraception. And I was mentioning this London summit call by the UK government, Melinda Gates Foundation, governments, and we sat together, UN, governments, private sector, of course the UNFPA as a leading force, are expanding access to family planning, and I really think this is a fantastic support that will permit us really to respond to women's need and to decrease maternal mortality. And this is especially important for young women. Today, pregnancy and maternal conditions are the number one killers of 15 to 19-year-old girls, adolescent girls worldwide. And these girls are twice as likely as women are in their 20s to die during pregnancy or childbirth. But when we're talking about under 15, the risks are five times higher. And one could think, well, but this is really not happening. Unfortunately, it is happening. Despite all this risk, one in seven girls in the developing world marries before the age of 15. And this is why UN agencies have joined together this year for the first, that was the 10th of October, for the first International Day of the Girl Child, to call for an end to child marriage so girls can be girls and not brides. The Every Woman, Every Child campaign aims to save the life of 16 million women and children, prevent 33 million unwanted pregnancy, and stunting in 88 million children, and protect 120 million children from pneumonia by 2015. And I think this is an enormous and unprecedented undertaking. But it is achievable through partnership and concerted action across sectors that strengthen health system and address the social determinants of health. A vaccine or AIDS treatment works so much better if a person has food or say water or sanitation. Contraception works better if a woman can take her own decisions about her body and her life. Public health improves when efforts are also taken to fight poverty, violence, and discrimination. And if there's one thing I would like you to remember from my talk today is this. All over the world, in every country, women and girls are standing up for their rights. They're standing up for equal rights, for equal opportunities, but also for equal participation. And their fathers, grandfathers, brothers, uncles, husbands, and parents, and partners, sorry, not parents, partners, are increasingly standing beside them. Well, in some countries more than others, I have to say. But it is happening, and we really believe that women's right is not the right issue of the women, it's everyone's right. So at this time in history, in the second decade of the 21st century, we are in a new phase of understanding as humanity. We realize that reaching our potential as communities, as countries, and human civilization requires unleashing the full potential of girls and women. And this requires a comprehensive approach that guarantees equal opportunities, rights, and participation for girls and women. So I thank you for all that you are doing. The arc of history is bending, and it's bending, fortunately, towards human rights, women's rights, and equality. Thank you very much.
Very informative remarks. President Bachelet has graciously agreed to take questions. So we're going to take a few because it's already 7 o'clock. We'll start right here.
Madam President, thank you so much for those very important remarks and for the great work that you're doing. I'm Diana Mason. I'm the Rudin Professor of Nursing here and co-director of the Center for Health, Media, and Policy at Hunter College. And just as you have experienced and in your own professional life, the importance of women being at decision-making and policy-making tables is crucial to advancing this women's health agenda. The World Health Organization has almost no nurses in its central office, despite the fact that nurses are the frontline providers in most countries for advancing women's health. What would you recommend can be done to reverse this issue?
Oh, wow. I recommend that I speak with Margaret Chan, and I tell her, what are you losing? You're losing a great potential. Well, in my country, I have to say that nurses and midwives were part of the solution of the health challenges. And one of the things when we discuss with people, with presidents, what are they going to do to improve the status of health or to decrease maternal mortality, usually people tend to think building huge hospitals and a lot of other things. And we say, no. Just have more midwives and nurses and train in these areas, and you will have the solution, and also have good transport system so you can derivate the cases that cannot be solved at the more basic level. So I think that all the personnel working in health needs to be where decisions are made, because we doctors, medical doctors, are not the only one who understand health. And we need the perspective, the different capacities, and I would say experiences that so you can really have a good knowledge. On the other hand, nurses, midwives, and other kinds of health professionals, I would say, are much better trained in administration, in management, but also on social determinants of health. And we all know that health is not about a treatment, a medicine. It's about how you deal with those issues in the society. So I will do my part, but let me think what else can be done.
Yes, thank you.
Hillary Cecil Jordan. My question is, how do you deal with or approach those countries that are not impoverished, but because of religion or culture, are not developing women?
There was two words that I could use. Persistence and patience, but because it's not easy. As you say, it's not an easy issue. What we have been trying to do with every country and with every region of the world is to build a very strong case why investing in women is not only the right thing to do, but the smart thing to do. Because there are people who will hear the message of human rights and they will make the right decision. But there are others who need to really understand that investing in women pays off socially, economically, even politically. So depending on where we go, we do give our message and advocacy in terms of the right thing to do, but also we try to convince government, we work with parliaments, we work even with religious leaders. Let me give you an example. There are many of the issues on health and other restrictions to the rights of women, like FGM, for example, female genital mutilation. And it's happening in countries where it's outlawed. It's not permitted, but it's still happening because the mothers believe that if they cut the girls, they will give her better opportunities. They will be seen as pure, and men will want to have her as wife, and she will have her life guaranteed because in those societies, marriage is what guarantees the life of their daughters. So the law is there in place, the police is there, the judiciary system is there, not always implement those laws, and we need to work on that. But we need to work on with religious leaders, with community leaders, with the mothers, and also with the boys. Because what you need is to change a social norm. It's not the law who will change culture and the social norm. So that's why, for example, we work a lot with young boys. And there are campaigns and young boys having teachers saying, I don't want to get married with a girl who's cut. So we need men on board. This is not the women's fight. It is, but it has to be also the men, boys, that sends the right messages. But having said that, it's not easy. And we have to find which are the entry points that will permit us advance in some areas that make us possible to advance in other areas as well. But we need more women in decision-making position. So that's why we put so much effort in any area in terms of more women in politics, because they're making decisions. Politics, I mean parliamentary, local council. Let me give you a little example. India. India has the biggest amount of, the highest absolute number of women elected at the local council. 1 million women elected. Of course, if you compare it to the population, the rate maybe is not that big, but it's the biggest. And what you see is that in all those councils, when you have female elected local council, the families believe that girls need to go to school. And girls believe they need to go to school. On the contrary, in those places where there's no female representation, the rates of girls' enrollment in school is much lower by parents who don't believe that it's important and girls who don't believe it's important. So when you need to fight culture or traditions, because sometimes it's more tradition, you need to find all the ways. The other way is to empower women economically. Because if women can earn an income, can get her family out of poverty, can show that women can, it also changes culture. Finally, you need to have a lot of symbolic gesture, and you have to find which are the right ones. I have all my life struggling for women's rights, but to be elected president was, and I was elected president because I was Minister of Defense. While I was Minister of Health, nobody looked at me. I was a caregiver, and women, what are we? We are always caregivers, so what's the new, you know? But defense minister, this is something different. So, but having been president, the attitude towards women changed. For the women itself, they look at themselves differently, but for men too. And I think, and this was not a policy, not budget allocated, it was something that permitted, and I did the first measure, 50% women, not only on cabinet and 50-50 parity, but all over the government. In every place that I could appoint people, 50-50. Because it was necessary to visibilize, because women are invisible, their portribution, they're visibilized that we have all over the world fantastic women and fantastic men. And that gives the clear clarity that we cannot lose that potential. So sometimes you can break your head thinking on fantastic thing, but I think symbolic is so important. I'm sure I mentioned to you, probably you have heard so many times from me, the case of Finland. Have you all heard it? Some of you, some not? Okay. You forgive me, you heard it. Because President Tarja Halonen, she just finished in March her 12-year term as President of the Republic. And she went when she was nine years in office. She went to a kindergarten, and she asked little children what they wanted to be when they were growing up. And the answers were the typical ones of every child here in the U.S., you know, firefighters, pilots, engineers, nurses, doctors, whatever. And then she goes to a little boy and said, don't you want to be the president of Finland? He was 6 years old. He had always been seen her as president. He said, in Finland, men cannot be president of the republic. So I think this is a beautiful story to say that we need to do so many different things, but we need to be civilized that women and power can also be together.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I understand, like, in you mentioned the Scandinavian countries, they have even quotas, like Norway, for how many women have to be in the positions of power. What's your opinion about the quotas?
Well, I mean, we call it, because quota is one of them, we call it transitional special measures. And we said transitional because the day there is equality, you won't need the kind of things that here in the US were called affirmative action. So we call it transitional special measures. And that has many different possibilities. Quota is one. And quota, I mean, Beijing stated in 1995 that in order that a parliament would really include in their legislation the concerns of 100% of population, women and men, it needed at least 30% of female representation. Today in the world we have 19%. Here is 16%, I think, in the US. And we have right now 33 countries in the world that have reached or a little bit over that proportion. Of the 33, only 5 didn't need quota. All the rest needed or quota or some kind of special. There are other countries who have tried to use the so-called paritarian and alternate list. In the list of candidate, it has to be 50-50, and they have to alternate the name of a man or a woman, because quotas is good, but it can be also tricky. They put all the women on the bottom of the list, and nobody goes to read the bottom of the list, so they're not elected. So I do believe that to increase political participation, quota is important. And it is an artificial discussion, the thing of the talent of merit, because why should women be in a quota? We need good parliamentarian. That's the same for men. We need good ones. So, I mean, of course, it had to be good candidate and good person. That's not the question. But it's not only about political participation. In Norway, in particular, they have quota for on boards. And the experience after 5 years, and now in this minute, it's discussed in the between the Commission of the European Union. And they're going to discuss again in November. But in Norway, the experience has been great, because it's not about having women because of having women. I mean, of course, it will be a society more democratic because it represents better everyone in the society. But it's also because it has an added value. And the experience in Norway is not only that they could do it in 5 years, they put as a deadline, but the performance of the companies improved. So that's the good thing. It's not we have to have women because we have to have women. I mean, we should, but that's not enough. In Libya, I was telling to the women candidates, nobody's going to vote for you because you're a woman. They're going to vote for you because you have an attractive offer to give to the citizens. And people will vote because they believe in you and they believe what you're saying. So I believe, because I think it's an affirmative action needed, because the play field is not leveled. So if you put an unleveled play field, it's no possibility that women could have equal opportunities. But it has to be transitional. When it's solved, it's the same as you and women. We might not be to exist when women's rights and gender equality and women's empowerment is achieved. So if it was not clear, I do believe in them.
Speaking of equal opportunities, we want to get at least one man to ask a question.
Good evening, Madam President.
Good evening.
My name is Brian Thompson. I'm a returning student in the Hunter Human Rights Program. The question I would like to ask you is regarding women and girls and health issues, but it's a marginalized group who often aren't included in the conversation. And it's a lengthy question that I wrote during your speech. Considering the role of women sex workers in both developed and undeveloped nations, what is your stance on harm reduction theory, providing for complete medical coverage, education on safer sex behavior, things which can combat the spread of bloodborne diseases and prevent unwanted pregnancies, supported by local government and not subject to any repercussions?
Yeah, but I didn't understand what the question exactly is, because what I think I spoke about that in my words.
You spoke about communicable diseases. My question is, what is your stance and your organization's stance on harm reduction theory, which would supply and provide these women with medical treatment, education for the sex workers without the fear of repercussion from local governments, actually as a matter of public policy?
Oh. Well, I think that every woman has to have access to health services, to education, and to bigger opportunities. In particular, of course, people who are sexual workers, they have to have it okay, of course. I mean, in my country, we always had it. We had the STD clinics where, and one of the things that we're discussing on with our friends from UNFPA and UNAIDS is that in order to be more effective, what we need to also organize is the health services so they can really ensure that that attention is the right one. So, for example, we're thinking on how we can ensure a more, how could I say, integrated health services in terms of reproductive health plus HIV/AIDS clinics. Because in many countries they have separately and they don't deal with it correctly. No, I truly believe that you have to develop those kinds of programs. They are essential, and it's the right of every person, whatever their activity is.
President Bachelet, may I ask the closing question? You mentioned at the outset of your remarks that women appear to be less prone to corruption. Do you think if there were more women leaders in the world, we'd have fewer wars?
I have a scientific formation, so I tend to not be a traditional politician that can say, of course, I'm sure that I will be like that. Very short questions, you know, answers, how you call that, sound bites and black and white. I'm not that kind of person, and you have noticed it because of the length of my talk. But I mean, I cannot ensure that women are the vaccine to all the problems of the world. That would have been completely false, and any generalization is always false. But having said that, what we have seen is that women do tend to find ways of solving problems, first preventing problem and solving problem, using some of women's, I don't know if natural or learned in society, abilities. So let me give you an example. Los Angeles police has found that women in their force are much better and resolve conflict in streets without repression using their interpersonal relationships. So women have some abilities that can be very helpful dealing with conflict, dealing with social unrest, and dealing with discussions. Women tend to try to find win-win solutions. Not always win-win solutions are possible, but tend to try to put themselves in the foot of the ones who are discussing, not to hear what they're saying, but try to understand what's under, particularly if they're trained for that. So I truly believe that, I mean, when you see the peace agreements, that after 5 years, usually 50% of them have failed. Of course, and usually none of them women had been an important part of agents of peace in terms of the negotiations, I mean. They could have been in the streets and doing their job. So I'm not saying they failed because they weren't women. That would be false, of course. But maybe if we really are able to introduce in the different, in the political forces, in the negotiating things, more women, I hope that will be. And the final thing that I'm going to say, I shouldn't say it, I have to say, but I know. But I'm a witness of that. I have seen situations with high-level political authorities where, if I may use this word, I'm sorry to use it, but I'm a doctor, testosterone has played a very bad, very bad role. And I have to say it. I've seen presidents almost getting to push themselves. And we female present have to be in the middle and trying to bring calm and get cool. And we are the hysterical, theoretically, the women. So I have to say, this is not scientific, but I've seen it. I've seen it many times, you know? Well, there can be hysterical women, I'm not saying that not, but what I mean to say is that sometimes the way to approach issues needs, I think, that's why the universe, and somebody would say God, whatever your beliefs are, has created us, men and women. We are complementary. We have our own capacities, and I truly believe that, I wouldn't say all wars will end, but it would be a more peaceful, but for another last reason that we have seen in Liberia and other places. When there are wars, their children are killed, their children are transformed in soldiers, and women don't want that. And really they're gonna do the biggest effort to stop any kind of situation. So maybe it's not a solution, but it's clearly part of the solution.
Please join me in thanking President Bachelet.